But we're going to continue this morning talking about, we've been talking about the days of Elijah, and I started last week talking about the political import of that and how we as the church in the land actually have the mantle of Elijah upon us because John the Baptist was the Elijah that was to come. I know that because Jesus said so. And yet he said that the least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than John the Baptist. So as I put it last week, these are the days of Elijah, but he ain't here.
Right.
We are. And sad as, you know, anybody remember who Jerry Garcia was?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was kind of a Grateful Dead fan back in the day. He made a statement. He makes great ties, doesn't he? He made this statement. I thought it was incredibly perceptive. He said, looking around, I know that somebody has to do something. It's just incredibly pathetic. It has to be us. But, you know, we're all God's got to work with. And he apparently wanted it that way, so we might want to cooperate with that. And so last time we talked about the things that are, I think, for me, biblically speaking, non-negotiable as Christians in determining not who we vote for, but what we vote for. And I'll be even plainer maybe than I was last time. We have two presidential candidates that I wouldn't invite to my house. You know, I might meet them out in a public place somewhere. I don't know that I want anybody to, I mean, I don't have much to steal at my house, but I'd be afraid for either one of them. I don't think Trump would steal anything. Amen, but we'd keep the young women under lock and key.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't mean to be facetious, but good gracious. Really, you know. But one of them's going to be president of the United States here in just a little bit. And scary as that might seem, we need to have some sort of a say-so in which one it is. So how do you decide between a lecher and a crook? I'm not sure. Is that plain enough for you? And, well, come on now. We're I believe, told to be part of the society that we're in. And we have, at least in this case, something of a say-so in the process. So it seems we ought to at least look at what they supposedly believe about stuff. So we looked last time at the three non-negotiables, which are, for me, the right to life, amen, and the position on the First Amendment, freedom of speech and freedom of religion, amen, and the third one is the position on Israel. I mean, there's a lot of other things that I'm concerned about, don't misunderstand me, but I think those three are, biblically speaking, almost, I don't see how you can get around using those as some sort of a test. In Malachi chapter 4, in the 5th verse, the Bible says, "Look, I'm sending you the prophet Elijah before the great and dreadful day of the Lord arrives. His preaching will turn the hearts of fathers to their children, the hearts of children to their fathers. Otherwise, I will come and strike the land with a curse." I believe that Matthew 11 tells us that we are the Elijah in the land now. And if we don't speak up and stand up, that the curse is coming. Amen. He also said in James chapter 5 that Elijah was as human as we are, in verse 17. And yet when he prayed earnestly that no rain would fall, none fell for 3.5 years. Then when he prayed again, the sky sent down rain and the earth began to yield its crops. Elijah was as human as we are. I don't know about you, but I'm pretty human. But it says that when he prayed, the rain stopped for 3.5 years. So, I think the import of that passage is supposed to be that when we pray, stuff happens.
Amen.
So at the very least, we ought to be praying.
Yes, sir.
Amen. So, we looked at those three things, but this morning I want to continue just a little bit. Most of you have probably already voted. But, there's some other things coming up that we need to be aware of, and maybe you need to instruct other people, let them know. I have right here, by the way, a civics test that comes right off the U.S. government immigration website and has questions on it, 100 questions on it, to prepare you for the citizenship exam. I was just thinking the other day that now there would be a good test for every high school graduate in the United States. I don't think you ought to be able to graduate from high school until you can at least pass the citizenship test that people coming from other countries have to pass. I don't think that's unreasonable. I think when I run for mayor, that's what I'm going to, maybe I think they absolutely ought to have to take it. Absolutely. I've talked to people, and how can you possibly take part in the government here without understanding what in the world's going on? I hear people cussing the Electoral College. Well, if you stop and study the history of the Electoral College, it's a pretty good idea. If we didn't have an Electoral College, then there wouldn't be any use having an election any place but in New York and California. Because the rest of the smaller states would have absolutely no say in the process. Amen. Would you want every president elected by nothing but the big cities in the country? Amen. Amen. There is a rationale behind it. Amen. So anyway, I'm not going to give you the test this morning. I thought about it. But I believe that probably we better take a little class on civics for just a minute first. And we're going to start our civics class with two scriptures, Ephesians chapter 2 and John chapter 8. Here's a question from the civics test. What document is the supreme law of the land in the United States?
Constitution.
The Constitution. Thank you. Well, I thought we better check, make sure we're on the same page. How many of you have ever read the Constitution? Okay. Ephesians chapter, you haven't? It's really not that long. Pretty quick read. Some of it's a little weird language for us today, but if you stop and get the dictionary, you'll get through there. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 said, "And you he made alive." If I look at somebody and say, that would be you.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. "Who were dead in trespasses and sins." Say, I used to be dead.
I used to be dead.
"In which you once walked." You were the walking dead, apparently.
Yeah, I was walking dead. Dead head.
Hey, y'all getting a lot of lesson this morning. "In which you once walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience." The spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience. What spirit is that that's working in the sons of disobedience?
Devil.
Satan. Okay. "Among whom," that is the sons of disobedience, "also we all once conducted ourselves in the lust of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath." We were by nature, everybody say nature.
Nature.
Children of wrath. The nature of man without Christ is driven by the lust of the flesh and of the mind, and is controlled by Satan himself. Sometimes we forget stuff. Look in John chapter 8. Speaking of the nature of Satan himself, let's look over here. I would go so far as to say this: you cannot understand the wisdom of the United States Constitution without a biblical understanding of the fallen nature of man. John chapter 8, verse 44. Jesus talking to the religious characters around him at this point, verse 44. He said, "You're of your father, the devil." You think I'm blunt? "And the desires of your father you want to do." You're of your father the devil, and you like to do the stuff that he likes, basically. "He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it." So talking to unsaved, even religious people, he said, "You're of your father the devil, you have his nature, and you follow his desires." Amen?
Amen.
Well, what does that tell us? Well, in the world today, basically, and even in most of our elections, if you get people, you can never get people past all the BS and get back to why they believe what they believe, then you can find out what the core of the issue is. And the people in the progressive left believe that man is basically good, and that if you just educate him better and train him better and make sure that he has plenty to eat and plenty to drink and good clothes to wear, that he will eventually act right. Amen. And then the other end of the spectrum, of course, is those of us who believe that man is inherently evil because of his fallen condition, thanks to that, I call it the Adam thing, you know. Thanks to that, we've been messed up since that day. And that's why we need to be what? Born again. So, if whichever side of that camp you come from, it really determines a lot of what you think about political issues. Amen. Jesus was pretty clear about it. Remember in John chapter 2, it said he didn't trust himself to men because he knew what was in men. Amen. He loved them, but he didn't trust them. That's our commission. Amen. You see, much of our public policy is based on misunderstandings of this difference. Jesus knew what was in man, and therefore he didn't commit himself to any man because he knew what was there. In that Romans chapter 1, it says, fallen man is busy worshiping the creature rather than the creation rather than the creator, and denying the existence of the creator and believing that their wisdom will suffice. That's exactly what the difference is in the political sides now. Amen. I think I told you last week that in almost everything political, we need to ask ourselves the question of who gets to decide on every question. Where is the buck going to stop with life? Who decides when life begins and whose job it is to end it? Who do you want in charge of that? I'm not sure I want Hillary or Donald in charge of that. Especially when it's my life. Amen. Who gets to decide what kind of speech we can have? Who can say what? What religious practices are okay and what aren't? Where does that decision rest? Who gets to decide what our position is going to be as a nation toward the nation of Israel? Who makes that decision? So as we look at those things, we need to think in terms of who gets to decide how we use resources and operate even our economic realm. No matter what economic or political philosophy you ascribe to, just remember that the nature of man guarantees that somebody will screw it up. Lord Acton, he was a British muckety-muck back in the 1800s, and he made this statement: power tends to corrupt, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. Great men are almost always bad men. Not quite all of a sudden, didn't it? So no matter what philosophy we ascribe to, then recognize that as long as fallen men are involved in it, they're going to foul it up. If you're a socialist, we heard that one thrown around this year a lot, good old Bernie. He just comes out and admits he's a socialist. What's that mean? He wants to take all your stuff and give it to somebody else. Y'all looking at me funny. That's what socialists believe. They believe that there ought to be a great committee somewhere that decides who can have what kind of job, who can have which house. Socialism is an economic and political theory advocating public or common ownership and cooperative management of the means of production. What's that mean? All of our businesses, all of our farms, all of our factories are run by the government. The means of production and the allocation of resources. That's one of those terms that just sounds kind of funny, but what's it mean? They decide who gets what. all the problems then of what they call a command economy come with those ideas. What's a command economy? That means the government decides who's going to make what and how many of it they're going to make. That's why when the Soviet Union fell, anybody remember the name of their famous car over there? What was it? Anybody remember? I can't remember the name of it now.
Starts with a Y.
Yeah, you're right. Why? Yugo. No, that's Yugoslavia. Was that it? When the Iron Curtain came down, there were fields filled with those things. They wouldn't run, but the government commanded them to make them because we want to have cars, and we think this car is the one we all ought to have. So once the government starts deciding what to make, then they have to start commanding people to buy it. Have you seen Obamacare lately? What is that? The result of a command economy. The government decided this is what insurance should look like, and now you have to buy it or else we're going to fine you. That's working out really well. Anyway, let's get off economics for a minute. Capitalism, on the other hand, because a lot of people think that's perfect too, but it's still made up of humans. Capitalism is an economic system in which the means of production are privately owned, and they're operated for private profit. Decisions about supply, demand, price, distribution, all that other stuff that the government was going to decide about now is made up by private people deciding where they want to invest their money, amen, and make some money. Now, I kind of like that idea. The problem with that, of course, is that people are greedy. And so that they will manipulate as much as possible to get as much out of whatever workers they have involved as possible and to produce things as cheaply as possible, even if that means producing them in such a way that maybe they're not reliable. Amen. So, to say that I just believe in complete free market capitalism, I think, there's some people that believe that, people will take care of the poor, et cetera. No, they won't. So there has to be some sort of a balance somewhere along the way. But the problem, once again, is not the system. The problem is the people in the system. Hallelujah. Greed will drive money and power into the hands of those with no scruples. Amen. It's just the way it is. Why? Because they're fallen people. Amen. So, with that being understood, then what... Who is going to decide how our resources are used? Who is going to decide, what cars we decide we want to make? Who makes those decisions? Politically speaking, who do we want in places to oversee those kinds of questions? Well, I think those are important questions. I don't want to drive a Yugo. I got a Hyundai. I like it. I'm going to keep it. Amen. In our system of government, those decisions are very carefully dissected and kept separate. There are basically three safeguards in our system that keeps power out of the hand of one man or small group of people. It's designed for that. It's on purpose that they did it this way. Why? Because they understood that man is a fallen creature. You don't want anybody running your business. The first one, the first safeguard, is the rule of law. Now, we like to think we don't need the government to make rules, but without that, the term for that is anarchy. And anarchy, when it's populated by unsaved people, is horrible. Amen. Anybody ever been in a third world country where the law enforcement was essentially nil? Or when I first started traveling to Mexico, I thought the cops were worse than the criminals. Really, I was more afraid of the policia than I was of the thieves. I mean, at least the thief didn't have any executive power over me. I could at least fight him. If I fight the cop, I'm going to jail for fighting the cop, even if I was fighting him because he was stealing stuff from me, which he usually was. Amen. Mordita. Anyway, 1 Timothy chapter 1. Look there right quick. See, I've never been in a church where they talked about this before. Well, bless your heart. Now you have. Verse 8. But we know that the law is good. He's talking about the Old Testament law, of course. If one uses it lawfully, knowing that the law is not made for a righteous person, the law is not made for a righteous person, but for the lawless and insubordinate, for the ungodly and for sinners, for the unholy and profane, for murderers of fathers and murderers of mothers, for manslayers, for fornicators, for sodomites, for kidnappers, for liars, for perjurers. And if there is any other thing that's contrary to sound doctrine. But what's he saying? The law is made for people that don't act right without it. If you don't have rules, people will do that whole list right there. Have you noticed that? Amen. So the law is made to control the nature of fallen man to keep them from killing each other and us. Amen. That's a good thing. The law is necessary when people have the nature of their father, the devil. When the rule of law means that we set up the rules up front so people can then do what? Plan. If there are no rules, then I guarantee you, you're going to have a horribly flawed economic system. Because nobody will invest because we don't know if the whole thing's going to fall apart tomorrow. That's why the stock market gets all nervous around election time. Because they don't know what the next yo-yo is going to do. Amen. I can almost guarantee if Trump wins that the stock market will go all berserko for a couple of weeks. Because they don't know what he's going to do. Hillary, on the other hand, it'll stay relatively stable because they may not like what she's going to do, but at least they know. So they'll be busy, you know, instead of working in the market, they'll be busy hiding their assets so that when she raises taxes, that she won't get any of theirs. Rich people don't pay taxes. At least Trump's honest about that. Why would I pay taxes? I pay lawyers. They're cheaper. Y'all are laughing. I'm just telling you the truth. None of those multi-million, that's why they don't care. Yeah, let's raise taxes. Go right ahead. Call my accountant. Amen. Yeah. So, people, if we have the rule of law, that means we know what the rules are going to be so we can decide what we're going to do. Plan our lives. Our lives are not, that's why executive orders should be severely limited. Why? Because we don't have a king. And our lives ought not be determined by the whim of somebody's bright idea. Oh, it's Monday morning. Let's do this. Or bureaucrats who never got voted for into office make rules that change the entire flow of the economy. Go to West Virginia and see how they're doing over there. Come on. Somebody decided they didn't like coal, so they put a whole state out of work. That's why the Constitution is important. Amen. The nice thing about our Constitution, if you think it's wrong, it has ways to amend it, but it's hard to do. It's supposed to be hard to do. Anytime we ignore the rules, then we place everyday life in the realm of the arbitrary at the whim of bureaucrats. That's not a good idea. So the question is, who decides? There has to be, in our case, someone who will acknowledge that that's unconstitutional. That's why we have a Supreme Court, to protect us from whim. The second thing, the rule of law number one, the second thing, they call it the separation of powers, which flows right out of that. Our founders went to great lengths to establish three distinct and mutually dependent branches of government and separate the functions of government among all three so that none of them can run the whole show. That's supposed to be the idea. Why? Because you don't want one guy running the whole show. Why? Because he's of his father, the devil. So the executive branch is pretty small. It's got two people in it. The president and the vice president. Vice president's got a really good job. All he does is wait and show up for the Senate. In case they split 50-50, he gets the deciding vote. That's it. That's his whole deal. Amen. The second branch is the legislative branch. We have a bicameral legislature. Anybody know what that means? We got two houses of the legislature, the House and the House of Representatives and the Senate. And the Constitution actually tells exactly what each one's supposed to be responsible for. They seem to have lost their copy up there, but the House of Representatives is elected every 2 years and holds the biggest acts they're supposed to hold is the power of impeachment for the other offices. But they're all getting paid off and spend all their time running for office, so they don't want to make anybody mad. So instead of doing their job and throwing the bums out, they're over in the bums club with them. Am I being plain enough? They hold the power of impeachment. When somebody oversteps the bounds of the Constitution, the House is supposed to step up and say, quit that, or you'll be out of work. Amen. All financial appropriations start with the House of Representatives. Did you know that? They are supposed to, every year, present a prospective budget for the nation. They haven't gotten around to that in a long time. Amen. And they're supposed to be elected by popular vote in their local area communities, and those areas are determined by population. The number of representatives you have in the House of Representatives in any given state is determined by the population of the state, and then the districts of the House of Representatives are all chopped up according to population. And then we met Mr. Jerry. Have you all looked at the congressional districts in Arizona? Have you looked at the outlines of them? That's funny. It looked like somebody threw mud at a wall. I said, okay, that looks good. Gerrymandering. The Constitution tells us that they're supposed to redraw the districts every 10 years based on the census. Right? If they're going to be based on populations, then that makes sense, right? Good idea. So the two parties figured out that when they're in power, you know, and the party in power in the Congress gets to redraw the districts according to, because they got more votes. And so they redraw the districts to favor themselves. So the districts no longer represent the people in the district. You know, people in Tucson kind of have some things in common, right? But they thought they'd throw Yuma in with us, or, you know, right, because they're trying to, depending on who's in power, either they're trying to get as many Democrats as possible in the district or as many Republicans as possible in the district. Has nothing to do with our common life goals of being here. So they move, we got some from over here, and we've got some from over here, and we'll shoot this little skinny one up toward Phoenix. All right, until we get the right numbers in. And that's why the districts all look so funny. I mean, look at that. You can go online and look it up, the map of the congressional districts in the United States. It's psychotic. But how did that get that way? That's how that got that way. Amen. How many of you have been, just recently, like this last term, we changed a lot of the House districts here in Tucson and the Tucson area got changed. How many, some of you don't even know that you're in the right district. Are you Grijalva? We'll pray for you. Kirkpatrick? I'm happy to report I'm in McSally. So anyway, the point is this, that next time there's a census, they'll move it all around again. See, when they do it, for instance, with McSally, let's just take that as an illustration. Jim Colby was the representative from that House district for a long time. Did a good job. Nice guy. And he retired, and then what's her name, the girl that got shot? Giffords. She won it, but she was a Democrat. He was a Republican. And of course, when they realigned the district, of course, they tried to make the district more heavily Democratic. But that particular district has been consistently almost even. It's really a toss-up district. But I guarantee you that when they realign again, that whichever party is in power will do their best to fudge the lines on that district to get rid of some of the people from the other party so that when they have the election again, they can win that House seat. Why? Because the House of Representatives does what? Makes appropriations bills. And we like to run the House. Why? Because then we can spend money on our stuff. But anyway, I'm getting too bogged down in this. But anyway, so the House of Representatives is the lower house, they call it. And then the Senate is the upper house, which is made up of two senators from each state. Amen? The original purpose of the Senate was to represent the states, not to represent the people. Why? Because the United States, it wasn't the United People of America, it was the United States of America. It was a congregation, I've been at this too long, a confederation of independent states with their own independent governments, houses of representatives of their own, judicial systems of their own. And the federal government had very limited power over the states. And the senators were sent to Washington, what? To do business for their state. To represent the interests of the whole state. Back then, most states didn't even elect them. They were sent by the state legislature. That changed in 1913 to direct election in the states, the 17th Amendment to the Constitution. The big thing that the Senate is supposed to do is to try the impeachment cases that come from the House of Representatives. They can make recommendations to the House about appropriations bills, but they can't write appropriations bills. They're supposed to consent and advise on what? Presidential appointments and ratify bills that come to them from the House. Amen. But the reason that's done is so that the interests of everybody is represented evenly. The people are represented on a local level by the House of Representatives. The state is represented on the state at large level by the Senate. Amen. The third branch of power is the judicial branch, which the Constitution says the judicial power of the United States shall be vested in one Supreme Court and in such inferior courts as the Congress may from time to time ordain and establish. And so we've got a whole bunch of ordained and established hoo-has around the country and a Supreme Court. Their job is to basically determine disputes over what's constitutional and what's not. And the federal courts have really gotten bogged down in a bunch of other junk as time has gone by, judging over things that should remain in the states, but we'll talk about that some other time. The third protection, the one protection we have is the rule of law. We got a ruling constitution. Number two, we have a three-part federal government with the powers separated among them and very specifically defined about who's supposed to do what to who and who can't do what, right? And when they get over those bounds, what starts happening? Tyranny is what starts happening. Amen. And then the judicial branch, who's supposed to be keeping score and refereeing the fight. But the third thing that the founders put in the document to protect us from all of that stuff is the sovereignty of the individual states. We'll go to the civics lesson now, and I'll ask you to quote the 10th Amendment. The last amendment in the Bill of Rights. Anybody know what it says? The powers not delegated to the United States by the Constitution, nor prohibited by it to the states, are reserved to the states respectively or to the people. What's that saying? Everything that the Constitution doesn't speak about is supposed to be determined at the state level. If it doesn't say in the Constitution, this is what the federal government shall do, then they're not supposed to do it. Got quiet then. The 10th Amendment was added as part of the Bill of Rights because the people that were forming the Union were afraid of a powerful central government because they just came from King George. Now we got King Barry. Well, we had King George before that. The idea was that the states remained sovereign in governing themselves, that the federal government was to deal with only issues that affected everybody as a whole. So the question then becomes again, who decides? No individual or associated group of individuals can justly rule others. And so we try to divide that up so nobody gets to run the whole show. Okay, is that enough of a civic lesson for today? Those things are incredibly important, and most people don't even know what they're supposed to do. My. So, what are we going to do? Well, we're going to have an election on Tuesday. Turn to 1 Timothy 2. I know y'all know this scripture, but let's see if you're doing it. Hallelujah. 1 Timothy 2, verse 1, the Apostle Paul says, "Therefore I exhort first of all that supplications, prayers, intercession, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and all who are in authority." Why are we doing that, Paul? "That we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man, Christ Jesus." So the first thing I want you to get today as we head into Tuesday is that we're supposed to pray for whoever wins and whoever's there now. Paul was asking prayer for a government that was probably as corrupt as any in the history of the world. You think we got problems. Rome in that day was not some place that you necessarily wanted to be a Christian. Amen. But he said pray for those that are in authority. So that would include our current leaders as well as future leaders. Amen. He didn't say pray for the ones you like and not for the ones you don't like. He didn't say pray that they'll drop dead, although I'm sometimes tempted. If I can't think of anything else to pray for, dear friends, I pray for their salvation. Amen. But some days I just think, I can't pray for anything else today. I can't believe that this guy... But Lord, send laborers across his path. Amen. Let him see Jesus for real. Amen. The point is so that we can live a quiet and peaceable life, not just so we can hang around and be quiet and peaceable, but so we can preach the gospel so that all men may come to the knowledge of the truth. That there's one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, and people that don't know that and acknowledge that are going to burn in hell forever. We have serious business to be taken care of. We can't be fooling around with politicians. Amen. Amen. So we pray for the politicians and preach the gospel until they cut our head off. So, pray. Everybody say pray.
Pray.
One of the scriptures that we've been standing on in this election cycle is in Psalm 75. Let's look there. Especially in this particular time when I have a hard time praying for anybody. I mean, I pray for certain people that I really believe that they're on the right side of the issues and that they're honorable people, and I pray for them to get elected, bless God. You know? But right now, there's a lot of folks, especially at the national level, that I'm thinking, I don't know about any of them. Amen. I can go by what they say, but they don't go much by what they say, so why should I? So in Psalm 75, I've been leaning on this one a lot. He said, verse 6, "For exaltation comes neither from the east, nor from the west, nor from the south." So if it's not the east, the west, or the south, what does that leave? The north. Who sits on the north? That's an allusion to the throne of God. Amen. Which sits on the sides of the north in the holy Jerusalem. Are you listening to me? Amen. So the sides of the north is where exaltation comes from, not the east, the west, or the south. Sometimes you have to explain things to folks. Verse 7, in case you didn't get it, he said, but God is the judge. He puts down one and exalts another. Amen. He puts down one and exalts another. Judgment comes from the Lord who is seated on the sides of the north. He puts down one and exalts another. So I've been calling into record on his scripture. Lord, exalt one and bring another one down. Because I can't see that there's any of them that even polite people would want to be around. So you pick them out, you can see hearts. Amen. Amen. And then turn with me to Proverbs 16. I think it was Jen Tringa was reading from some stuff that was teaching about leadership in the conference. And she quoted a couple of things. So I went over and looked at the whole passage. No, that's pretty good. I like that. Proverbs 16, talking about good leadership. How many of you want good leadership?
Yes, sir.
All right. I'm going to read from the Message Bible. Verse 9 says, we plan the way we want to live, but only God makes us able to live it. Amen. A good leader motivates, doesn't mislead, doesn't exploit. God cares about honesty in the workplace. Your business is his business. Good leaders abhor wrongdoing of all kinds. Sound leadership has a moral foundation. Good leaders cultivate honest speech. They love advisors who tell them the truth. An intemperate leader wreaks havoc in lives. You're smart to stay clear of someone like that. Good-tempered leaders invigorate lives. They're like spring rain and sunshine. Well, I read that and I thought, yeah, I want that guy.
Yeah.
And all them things it says about good leaders there, I want that guy. Where is he? She. Yes, I don't even care. Amen. Well, I can't see folks' hearts, can you? But the Lord can. So I've just been praying, Lord, I want somebody that you know at least has the capacity to be this kind of a leader. I don't know who that is, but I'm praying for it. You exalt them, you bring others down, put somebody there that will fill this bill. I going by what I can see, they ain't out there. You go by what you can see and what you know you can do in them once they're there. Amen. Amen. So let's pray, can we? Let's just pray right now. Let's pray about this election. Father God, we just thank you. We want a good leader. We want good leaders all the way up and down the scale. Father God, in the office of the president, we surely want somebody who has a moral foundation. We surely want somebody who doesn't mislead and doesn't exploit. We surely want somebody, Father, who cultivates honest speech and has advisors that tell them the truth. We want somebody who's temperate, not intemperate. We want somebody who's good-tempered, that brings invigoration and that brings about refreshing like a spring rain. We thank you for that. Father, I don't know who that is, but you know. You have the ability to see hearts and you can see the future. You know what can happen with any given individual. If they're able or willing to attain to your goodness, to attain to your righteousness, to follow your leading when they're in that office. So, Father God, we thank you as the one who raises up some and brings some others down. Raise up a good leader. You said that's what they look like. We want one that looks like that. You shouldn't have put it in there if we couldn't have one. So we want one that looks like that. Amen. Bring them up. Raise them up in the name of Jesus. We thank you for it, Father. We praise you for it, Father. We thank you for establishing righteousness in the land. We thank you. You said a leader should establish the land by justice and not receive bribes. We're looking for somebody who won't be moved by money in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. You said, Father God, that our leaders should be those who respect the voiceless poor and treat them fairly. We're asking for somebody that will have compassion on the poor and on the needy and those who have no voice in this process. Thank you for that leader. You said in your word, Father God, that our leaders should hate corruption. So in the name of Jesus, we're looking for leaders that hate corruption. Oh, Father, oh, please, bring us leaders that are just, their stomach is turned by public corruption in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, for righteousness in the offices of our land and particularly in the presidency of these United States. Oh, Father God, if they're not there now, change them and get them in there. We thank you for it. We thank you for bringing up one, bringing another one down in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Now, I want to commission you to go home and pray these scriptures in your own prayer closet between now and Tuesday. We prayed last Sunday night. We prayed exactly according to these scriptures right here. And we started praying in the Holy Ghost just here in the room. There's about 20 of us in here praying Sunday night. And as we prayed, there came one of those moments when the Spirit of God just came in the place. It just... I always call it a swell, you know, like all of a sudden it just went up to another level. You could just tell it, and everybody started praying. There wasn't nobody orchestrating it or nothing. We were just walking around, kneeling down, praying, you know, praying in the Holy Ghost. But all of a sudden, you could just feel it come in the room. And it stayed that way for a pretty good little while. We just kept praying, and then it began to subside a little bit. But the Lord spoke to us a couple of things by the Spirit. One of them was, you are now in the gap. And I knew what he was referring to when he said that because I have a Bible. And I'm prone to read it every once in a while. In Ezekiel 22, he said, I sought for a man, in the 30th verse, I sought for a man among them who would make a wall and stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land that I would not destroy it, but I found no one. I don't like that found no one part. But he was looking for somebody that would stand in the gap and make up the wall in protection of the land to stay the judgment of the Lord. Amen. In that moment, the Lord said, you are now in the gap. He said, do not be deterred. Stand firm. Stay in the gap. Look at somebody and say, stay in the gap. Amen. Don't move. We can't afford to move until this thing is done. Let's see it through to the end. Amen. Let's see it through. Stay in the gap. He said, don't be deterred or be moved by circumstances and the things you hear and see around you. Don't be up and down with every poll and up and down with every crazy statement that some goofy politician makes. Amen. The people in the media are fallen people as well. They're being paid to say what they say. Amen. And even the ones that are not being paid off by the politicians are being paid off by their advertisers. Amen. Because if you want to sell cookies, you don't want somebody talking about things that don't make people hungry for cookies right before that. So you want to make sure. Come on. Amen. Because people associate the advertisers with the shows that they advertise. And so the advertisers say, you have to keep your show in this kind of a bounds or we won't pay you any money. Come on. Don't get all caught up in what's going on in the world. Why? The world is corrupt. That's why. Amen. Amen. I mean, it's okay to get facts and figures and so forth. That's fine. But don't, just because somebody is excited about something or don't talk about something or does talk about something, don't just assume that that's, you know, Mount Olympus coming down with the truth. No, you have the Holy One of Israel on the inside of you and you got a book that he wrote you telling you what to do. So stick with that. Let's stay in the gap and make up the wall so that judgment can be forestalled. Amen. So take those scriptures in with you. And then finally, whoever gets elected, from the presidency standpoint at the very least, our nation is going to be very different on Wednesday. Either one. So no matter who gets elected, let's remember this, that the ultimate outcome and justice for man in the long haul comes from the Lord. Amen. So we trust Him to bring that about. In Proverbs 21:1, it says, the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. Like the rivers of water, He turns it wherever He wishes. So we can certainly pray that whoever wins, that the Lord will turn their heart in the direction that pleases Him. Amen. We stand on that. And I want to admonish you I hear all kinds of stuff about where there's going to be violence in the streets, and you know, both ways. Whether there'll be a peaceful transition of power. One of the astonishing things about our nation is that this very diverse and powerful nation has, lo, these many moons now, 240 years, continued to transfer power in an orderly fashion without violence, election cycle after election cycle after election cycle. The only president we've ever had that hijacked the power of the presidency was Franklin Roosevelt. Don't look at me in that tone of voice. He, first of all, allowed him to run for a third term. That had never been done before. George Washington refused to run for a third term because he didn't want to establish, amen, a monarchy. He said, no, this is a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. It's time for another one of the people to take this job. People wanted him to stay. Why? He did a heck of a job. Amen. Amen. But Roosevelt decided he was the only man that could save us. And so he served four. And then what happened? We passed a constitutional amendment saying, two's it. So now two's it for the president. So other than that one little blip in the course of history, it's been consistent. Now, he didn't violently overthrow the government, but he overstepped what was the understood tradition and value from the very beginning. And immediately people rose up and said, you know, we did that, but that wasn't such a hot idea. Let's undo that. Amen. Now, so we planned, I believe we'll have another orderly transition. But it's going to be a difficult time for our nation. And I don't know about you, but some of the stuff I see makes me just violently angry. Amen. But Titus chapter 3. Everybody say, we Christians.
We Christians.
Amen. Every now and then I like to just check my sanctification with somebody for a minute so I could go do something. Amen. Be right back and pick it up when I'm done. But I don't think that works that way. No. Titus chapter 3, verse 1. Remind them, this is talking to Titus, he said remind them, meaning the people in the church, remind them to be subject to rulers and authorities, to obey, to be ready for every good work, to speak evil of no one, to be peaceable, gentle, showing all humility to all men. Amen. I was struck this week, just interestingly enough, what's his name? The crazy ex-Pentecostal woman, Katy Perry, and she was raised Pentecost, you know. And then what's his name, the rapper? Jay-Z. We don't know his real name, but he goes by the alias of Jay-Z. His mother probably named him Throckmorton, but I changed my name. But anyway, you don't know what their names are. But anyway, they did a concert in support of one of our candidates couple of nights ago, and they couldn't even show it on the news because the language was so vile. Touting violence. You know, if they don't get our way, we're going to burn stuff and act crazy and calling people names that, you know, if we did that, we'd go to jail. Amen. And then I was so blessed, we were watching the Country Music Awards. Judy taped it for me while I was out of town. But this struck me, the number one song, the best song of the year. Amen. Think about this for a minute. Just it gave me confidence again that there really are decent humans alive in the land. The name of the song, it was the best song of the year voted for by the whole schmear. You know what the name of it was? Humble and Kind. The lady wrote it as a prayer for her child that he would grow up to be humble and kind. So I don't know about you, but I'm going to go with that bunch.
Me too. Amen.
Amen. That tells me there's a whole bunch of us out there somewhere that are looking for godliness, kindness, gentleness, meekness. Come on.
Amen.
Amen. And in this time, whatever our nation does and the crazy people do around us, we need to remain humble and kind, because people are going to hell out there, and what they don't need is my political opinion slapping them up the side of the head and arguing with them, calling them names. Amen. Amen. Unless they ask me for it, of course, and then I'll to them with both barrels. But amen. Hallelujah. Everybody say humble and kind.
Humble and kind.
We should have sung it this morning. But what's the guy's name? Tim McGraw sang it. But it was somebody's mama that wrote it, which I thought was kind of cool. The last place we're going to stop is in Acts chapter 4. Let's look there. I know this is kind of a downer, but bear with me. God's going to do some amazing stuff in just the next few days. Keep your eyes open. Keep your eye. We're not moved by what we see. We're not moved by what we feel. We're not moved by circumstances. We're moved by the Word of God and the love of God on the inside of us. So stay steady no matter what happens.
Yes, sir.
That's the message. Pray. First and foremost, pray. Be, stand up. Be bold and strong in what you believe. Just don't be ugly about it.
Right. Amen.
Amen. Doesn't mean change what you say, but change the way you say it. Maybe that will be the best way to. Here in Acts chapter 4, they had been commanded not to preach or teach anymore in the name of the Son of God. And their prayer when that happened comes to my mind. Verse 29, let's start right in the middle of the prayer. He said, "Now, Lord, look on their threats and grant to your servants that with all boldness they may speak your word by stretching out your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done through the name of your holy servant, Jesus."
Amen.
Stretch forth your hand to heal. Give us boldness to proclaim it. And let signs and wonders be done in His name.
Yeah.
Amen. Stand up with me. Amen. Amen. Whatever happens on Tuesday, I'm going to wake up on Wednesday praying that signs and wonders be done in the name of His holy child, Jesus. I'm going to pray that He stretches forth His hand to heal. I'm going to pray that I have boldness to say the truth, no matter what anybody thinks about it. Are you willing to pray that with me? Amen. Amen. The one thing I know is this, that people are not going to flock to a God that you don't think is worthy of obedience. We try to convince people to serve God by acting like the world. Amen. Why would I serve a God that you don't even think is worthy of obeying? Come on. Hallelujah. Well, let's pray it. Heavenly Father, fill us with your boldness. Fill us with your boldness. Fill us with your boldness. Boldness to proclaim the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Boldness, Father God. Boldness, boldness, boldness in preaching your word. You stretch forth your hand to heal. Let signs and wonders be done in the name of your holy child, Jesus. Father God, we pray for revival in the streets, but revival in the streets only comes when the people of God are in the streets preaching the word of God. There's only one way in the New Testament that it comes, by the power of the Spirit. But the power of the Spirit only comes when the people of the Spirit stand up and speak the truth in love, Father. So we just thank you for boldness to proclaim that truth. 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 Oh, we thank you and we praise you for it. Stretch forth your hand to heal. Hallelujah. Who needs healing in their body today? Where are you? Wave like this at me. Agar needs it. Right here, who else needs healing in their body? Emily need healing? Put your hand on that young lady right there. Let me all get over here and pray for Agar. Thank you, Lord. Oh, Rabbi. Anybody else need healing in your body? Stretch forth your hand to heal, Lord Jesus. Stretch forth your hand. Did I miss anybody? We got one back there. Who else needs healing in your body? Don't want to miss anybody. Amen, amen, amen. Oh, Rabaha Shikati Libazdaka. Oh, Roboko Shikatala Basifi. Bless you, Lord Jesus. Bless you, Lord Jesus. Go ahead and just pray. Open your mouth and pray. Wait for me to pray. Oh, Rabaha Shikati Bi. Stretching forth thine hand to heal, O Lord. Stretching forth thine hand to heal, O Lord. Stretching forth thine hand to heal, O Lord. Oh, Roboko Shikatala Basaka. Oh, Roboko Tolobo Sheke. Mombre katelebe jeke. Gembra baka sheke teleba zaka. Oh, roboko lolobokonche katalamas. Oh, rabaka sheke telema sakatala. Stretching forth thy hand to heal, O Lord. Oh, roboko sheke teleba saka. Oh, rabaka sheke katalaba sakatalaba suku. Oh, roboko doloshke telebe sike. Oh, roboko sheke teleba sike. Oh, rabakandalaba shaka. Stretch forth thy hand to heal, O Lord. Now, this minute, signs and wonders are done in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Signs and wonders are done in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Signs and wonders. Signs and wonders. Signs and wonders. Oh, Rabakashika, I speak to bones and ligaments and command them to be whole in Jesus' name. Oh, Robokoshika Tebrifa. In the name of Jesus. Oh, Rabakasheke. Oh, Robokoshia Lalabakasefe. Mombro Kotoloshkila Maraga Devideshke. Thank you, Lord. 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 Lift your hands up and just thank Him now for His precious healing power. Oh, Robokoshia. I will adore you. Oh, we worship you, Jesus. Holy, holy. Creation, I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything. I will adore you. Oh, thank you. Sing that first verse. Worthy is. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. That again, worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. Sing faithful. Faithful is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. Mighty. Mighty is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. Jesus is the Lamb. Jesus is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. Let's sing the chorus. Holy. Holy, holy, holy. The Lord God Almighty was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything. I will adore you. Father, we thank you as we look forward to what you're going to do this week. I thank you for the healing power of God that touches every life in this house and that we carry it out of here, Father God, to a world that needs it. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen. Go get a cup of coffee.